We've looked at one-dimensional arrays and two-dimensional arrays. Both of those are collections of the same data type. But a structure is an abstract data type, a collection, if you will, that lets us combine different data types into one unit. Structures exist in high-level languages, and they also exist in assembly language. Here's an example of a C++ structure named pet. It has a string variable for the pet's name. It has a float for the weight. I chose float because that's going to fit into a 32-bit register. Something to think about. And an integer for this particular pet's age. These variables are called a structure's members. We use curly braces to enclose the structure's parts, and make sure you end it with a semicolon. You'll get all sorts of errors if you don't. Here are a couple of important points. With this code, you've declared a new type of data, and you've named it pet. This code is a pattern for the compiler, which means it doesn't declare a variable, which in turn means it doesn't set aside any memory space. The compiler is going to use this pattern if and when you decide to declare a variable of this type. And because it's just a pattern, usually we declare them globally, up above even the data segment. Now I can declare variables of type pet. Remember, each of these variables has its own name, weight, and age member variables, because each variable is based on the pet pattern. Now let's take a look at the assembly version of this pet data type. I put the C++ version up here in the corner just for reference. Notice how similar the assembly language code is to the high-level code. There are some differences, though. Terminology-wise, members in the assembly structure are referred to as fields. Here, I had to use name1 because name is a reserved word in MASM. The name1 field is an array of chars, rather than being a string object like we could use in C++. The weight field is a real 4 to correspond to the high-level float data type. To match the high-level declaration, I made age a double word, even though a byte would have worked to store something as small as an age. Finally, the structure definition is enclosed in these two directives. Like the C++ version, define your structure definitions globally, above the data segment. Now, I could put default values into the structure definition when it makes sense to. For example, I probably wouldn't want to do that for the name1 field. More about that later. But for the weight, I might want a default value of 0, and the same kind of thing for the age field. These default values come into play when we declare variables of a structured type. More about that in just a minute, too. First, let's mention aligning data to more efficient boundaries in RAM. The text reminds programmers that for the ultimate efficiency in assembly, data should be aligned to even-numbered boundaries in RAM. That is, unless you're talking about byte-sized data. Since a real 4 takes up 4 bytes, let's align it that way. And since a double word also takes up 4 bytes, the alignment is already set because of the align directive above. Again, the align directive is optional, but if you're going to try and get the fastest speed from the CPU, it really does help. Now that we've got the definition of a structure in our heads, how do we declare variables of that type? Our original way of defining the pet structure is up in the corner. In the data segment, now we can declare a variable of type pet. The brackets mean use the default values from the structure definition. Since our original definition didn't have default values, our variable will just contain junk. So here's what it would look like in RAM. Pay attention to a couple of things. First, for any pet variable, the structure takes up 28 bytes. The name1 field takes up 20 bytes, even if the pet's name is Spot. The real 4 weight field takes up 4 bytes. And the age field, a double word, takes up another 4 bytes. So if I use the type operator on this pet structure, it would indicate 28 bytes. If we use the version with default values shown at the top, here's what RAM would look like. I've just got a 0 showing for the weight and age fields, But keep in mind, those would actually be stored in real 4 format and double word format when they're in RAM. Now, the text discusses default values and examples about using them. My take on this is use them when it makes sense, and it might be best just to concentrate on numeric data. Of course, all of that depends on the logic of your program. The text also spends time talking about initializing a variable when you declare it. Let's take a look at that idea next. We've just seen an example of default values when declaring a pet variable. With pet 2, we're going to override any default values that might exist and initialize this variable with name Fido, weight 6.1 pounds, and age 3. The weight and age fields do just fine because they're numeric. But the name 1 field has a problem. Can you see what it is? The name 1 field is an array of chars acting like a string. But where's the terminating 0? Whoa! If I tried to use the name stored in this field, my program is going to be looking for terminating 0 to mark the end of the so-called string. That means it'll continue searching through RAM until it finds one, and that could be 20 bytes away or 20,000 bytes away, depending on what's stored in RAM. Is there a solution to this? One answer is go ahead and initialize the numeric variables at the declaration stage, if that makes sense. I'm doing that here with pet 3. This comma says to skip over initializing the name 1 field, then give values to weight and age. So for pet 3, RAM looks like this. Then in the code section, store a 0 terminated string into the name 1 field. You just have to make sure it doesn't go over 20 bytes. That would let you use the string primitive instructions with repeat prefixes, and that works out pretty well. What you don't do is what I did here with the pet 2 variable. Which brings up, could we do something more complex when declaring structure variables? I've got to ask you, do you want to see something really scary?
Okay, this is really, really scary now.
I trust you.
Okay, pull the car over.
Pull the car over?
Ooh. You want to see it?
Well, show me while I'm driving.
No, I can't. I can't tell you about it. It's only take a couple of seconds.
All right, 2 seconds, okay?
Okay.
What is it?
Just pull it over.
Okay.
I'll show you.
All right.
Okay.
Scare me.
Are you ready?
Okay, go ahead. What are you doing?
Okay, besides the Twilight Zone movie, how about declaring an array of structures? Now that might sound scary, but you pretty much already know how to do this. So start with our structure definition. Then, in the data segment, just do these steps. First, give the array a name. Here I'm calling this one My Pets. Then tell the assembler what type of data it is. Well, our data type is the pet structure. Then tell how many pet structures are going to be in the array and use the dupe operator to indicate that. Finally, don't forget the brackets to indicate we're going to use default values. Once we do that, here's what the array would look like in RAM. And the array name points to the first structure in the array. This is the end of structures part 1. In part 2, we'll take a look at storing and retrieving data inside of these structure variables. See you there.